Hi students, today's session will be about maxillary right hemianopia canine drawing session. Before starting drawing, we must read in our textbook about the canine, about everything, all aspects of the teeth, how it looks like, the position of the canine, and the description of all surfaces, and the important landmarks that should be kept in mind while drawing the canine. The important outline, we should know where is the contact point, medial and distally. As we know that the canine does not have an incisal edge, it has a cusp tip. That's why another name for the canine is called cusped. And we should know where the cusp tip lies. Also, the medial outline and the distal outline of the crown, how it looks like. The relation of the cusp tip to the long axis of the tooth from the maxillary aspect, from the very aspect. So we have to know the shape of the apex and where it lies according to the long axis of the tooth. And the form of the apex itself, is it round, is it flat, or is it pointed? For the proximal aspects, also we have to know where the maximum contour of the crown lies, and the shape of the form of the crown from the proximal aspect, and other landmarks that are important for our drawing.
The maxillary canine has an incisal edge that comes to a cusp tip. The mesial cusp slope is shorter than the distal cusp slope. There can be imbrication lines on the facial. The distal contact is in the middle third. The mesial contact is at the junction of the incisal and middle thirds. The distal outline can be quite convex in the contact area, and then there's a depression between the contact and the CEJ. There's a prominent labial ridge. From the lingual view, there are mesial and distal marginal ridges, a cingulum, and a fossa. This is the longest tooth in the whole dentition. On the proximal, the labial height of contour is in the cervical one-third. The incisal outline is more asymmetrical. The mesial on the right here, the labial is more rounded, and the labial on the distal is more concave.
This is our drawing paper, as we said always, on the top here, on the top, we should write the title of our drawing, palmar location, the pulmonary of the tooth, and the magnification factor. In square number one, the labial aspect. Square number two, the lingual aspect. In square number three, the proximal aspect, which is mesial, and in number four, distal aspect, in the center, the incisal aspect of the tooth. At first, we have to draw the labial aspect. We take one of the four areas of drawing, which is the area, or always we start with the labial aspect. We draw a horizontal line, which represents the incisal end of the tooth, or the crown end of the tooth, and we draw a horizontal line like this. Number two, on the horizontal line, we draw a vertical line. This is the vertical line, which represents the long axis of the tooth that runs through the crown, an imaginary line or a midline, which runs through the mid, the bulk of the crown and the bulk of the root. On that line, we have to identify that the first measurement that we have to put it on it is the crown. As we know from the table of measurement that the crown length is 10 millimeters multiplied by 4, so it will be 14, 40 millimeters upward, and I will put a mark. Then I will draw a horizontal line representing the cervical line. Then from this point, I have to draw the length of the root, which is 17 multiplied by 4, 68 millimeters. I will go 68 millimeters upward and put another mark here for the position of the root end of the tooth, which is the apex. So I have now two areas, one for the crown and one for the. Here I will have the root and here I will have the crown. Later on, the crown part should be divided into 3/3, as we said earlier. 40 divided by 3, it will be 30.43. For the ease of drawing, you may divide the terms into 13 cervically, middle third 14 millimeters, and the further third 13 millimeters. So I will draw 13 millimeters and put a mark, then I have to go 14, then I have to go 13. So the incisor third is 13 millimeters, the middle third 14 millimeters, and the cervical third 13 millimeters. The total is 40 millimeters. After we divide the crown into thirds, this image should be repeated 4 times for the lingual, for the media, for the rectal. It is the same thing. What differs is what we draw inside these two areas, whether it's the labial, the lingual, medial, or distal. The first aspect, as I said earlier, after we divide the crown into 3 thirds, the first aspect here down, we will write here labial, and on the sides I have the mesial and I have the distal. Start with the cervical measurement. Mediodistally of the canine, cervically is 5.5 millimeters, multiplied by 4.22, divided into 2 halves, 11 to the mesial and 11 to the distal. I will put the cervical points 11 and 11 millimeters at the cervical point. Then I have to know where is the contact point mediodistally, which represents the maximum width of the crown mediodistally. The mesial contact for the measurement is 7.5 millimeters multiplied by 4, it will be 30. So I have 15 millimeters to the mesial and 15 millimeters to the distal. Mesially, where it lies vertically, mesially it lies at the junction between the middle and the incisal third. So distally, I have to go another 15 millimeters from the midline, but where it lies vertically, it lies at the middle of the crown, in the middle of the crown. After I have pointed the two contact points, the next step is to draw the outline of the crown from the cervical point to the contact point. The mesial outline of the crown from the cervical point to the mesial contact point is slightly straight, while it is from the distal contact point to the cervical point is concave. So the mesial outline of the crown is straight or slightly convex, while the distal outline is slightly concave. Look to the crown labially, it has a cusp, as we said. What's the relation of the cusp to the midline? For the canine, the midline which divides the crown and the root, or runs through the bulk of the crown and the root, the cusp tip would lie at the center of this midline. So I have to draw the outline of the cusp tip like this. This is the cusp tip. Then I have to join the contact point to the cusp tip. This area from the contact point to the cusp tip, we call it a cusp slope. So I have a mesial cusp slope from the mesial contact point to the tip, and I have a distal cusp slope from the distal contact point to the cusp tip. This is the distal cusp slope. Both of them are slightly concave before we have taken slightly concave. So, as you notice here, that the mesial cusp slope is shorter than the distal cusp slope. After you finish the crown, now you will move to the root. The labial aspect, the general outline of the root is cylindrical, and two sides of the root, about 2/3 of the root, are slightly parallel. Then they taper toward a blunt pointed apex. What's the relation of the apex to the midline? of the midline either lies distal to the midline or maybe to the mesial, but in most instances it lies distal to this midline. The two-thirds of the root is slightly parallel, the sides, mesial and distal, then it tapers toward the apex. So I have to draw the cervical line. This is the cervical line which lies in the cervical third of the crown. A labial ridge, as you notice, this marked area at the center of the crown, this we call it the, this is the labial ridge. This labial ridge is concave at the middle, or it's inclined toward the mesial side. It's a curved line. A curved line runs from the center of the cusp to the center of the crown and is curved at the center of the crown, or in the middle of the crown, toward the mesial side. The area mesial to the labial ridge resembles the anterior teeth, while the area distal to this labial ridge resembles the adjacent teeth, which are the premolars. There is a depression on this side resembles the premolar, because the canine in a transition area between the anterior teeth and the posterior teeth. Moving to the lingual side, the same divisions. We have to buy the same divisions, three thirds, 30, 40, 15, midline, incisor line, cervical line, apical line, the same measurement. Then I have to mark the cervical points. The two cervical points, 11, 11. The two contact points, 15, 15. But the vertical position is different. Here will be the mesial, and here it will be the distal side, because now we are drawing a mirror image of the first view. It is a mirror image, but everything will be in reverse. Then I draw the two sides of the crown. Then I mark the position of the cusp. Then I draw the cusp slope, the mesial, the distal cusp slope, the apex of the root, the cylindrical root, then the cervical line. Lingually, as for the anterior teeth, there is a cingulum, and this cingulum lies in the cervical third. Here is the area of the cingulum. This is the position of the cingulum in the cervical third. The cingulum, from the center of the cingulum, there is a lingual ridge, as for the labial side, lingual ridge extending from the cingulum toward the incisal tip. And there is also two marginal ridges, mesial marginal ridge and distal marginal ridges, and the cusp slope ridges. The area in the center, we call it the lingual fossa, but because there is a lingual ridge, this is a lingual ridge, it will divide the fossa into two parts. Distolingual fossa and mesiolingual fossa. Moving to the proximal sides, the mesial and the distal. If you know the mesial, so the drawing of the distal will be very busy. At first, we have to mark the cervical points. The two cervical points, the buccolingual diameter of the crown at cervix is 7 millimeters, so I have to go 14 to the lingual and 14 to the labial side. We have to know the maximum contour of the crown. The maximum contour of the crown, labial and lingually, for the canine lies about 1/4 the total length of the crown. The total length of the crown is 40 millimeters. 1/4 is 10 millimeters. So from the center here, from the midline, I have to go vertically 10 millimeters and point a mark. On this mark, I will draw another line, horizontal line. At this horizontal line, I will mark the maximum contour of the crown lingually and labially. Lingually and labially, the maximum width of the crown is 8 millimeters, so I have to go 16 millimeters to the lingual and 16 meters to the distal, but where it lies, it should be on this line, the new line, which is the line at 1/4 the total crown length. 1/4 of 40 is 10 millimeters. As you can notice here, this is the line which is this is the line 10 millimeters. Here the area of the later on I have to join the cervical point with the maximum contour lingually. The cervical point are the maximum contour labially. Then I have to mark the position of the casket, where it lies. Is it at the center as the labial side, or it is lingual or labial to the smooth line? It is said that when if you have an imaginary line that runs through the bulk of the crown of the root from the proximal side, this the cusp tip or the incisor tip of the crown will lie labial to this midline, meaning that I will not draw the cusp tip at the center. It should be labial to this midline. And from the proximal side, it is as the central and the lateral incisor. The crown form is wedge shape or triangular shape. It has a base and a triangular tip. The base is the cingulum and the tip of the triangle is the incisor. Here is the position of the cusp tip. As you can notice here, the cusp tip is not at the center, it is labial to this midline. Then I have to join the buccal point, the maximum contour buccally, with convex line to the cusp tip. Convex line to the cusp tip. Lingually, the form of the crown like the central, it is spoon shape. It starts convex at the cingulum, then it becomes concave, then it joins the incisor tip, which is rounded. As you can notice here, also the cusp tip is not pointed, it is rounded. Because the lingual ridge is prominent, I will draw another line here inside the external outline of the crown. This line represents the mesial cusp slope and mesial marginal ridges. So the external outline, this line will be the lingual ridge, and the inside line will be the marginal ridge and the mesial cusp slope. Then I have to put the apex of the root. The apex of the root is slightly pointed, and it is also cylindrical from this view. It's also cylindrical from this. Then I have to draw the two sides of the root. The root apex is slightly pointed, and the root is cylindrical. About 2/3 of the sides of the root, labially are slightly parallel, then they take as well the apex. Then I have to draw the cervical line, and it is according to measurement. The mesial curvature of the cervical line is 2.5 millimeter multiplied by 4, so I have to go from this point, 10 millimeter, mark the position, then I have to join the lingual with the labial side by a curved line, which is the cervical line as you can see here. Also, there is a depression in the root, in the middle area of the root. This we call it developmental depression. We see it on the medial side or the distal side of the root. But the difference is that it is on the distal side is more deeper than the medial side. So this is the area of the developmental depression on the medial side of the root. You draw it like this. It is like a big square. The middle third of the root, in the middle third of the root. Moving to the distal aspect, it is the same thing, the reverse of the mesial aspect. The two cervical points, 40 for me and 40, then go 10 millimeter, draw another horizontal line for the area of the maximum contour labiolingually. Mark the two labial and lingual maximum contours 16-16 on this line. Draw a convex line for the area of the cingulum and the labial side of the crown. Mark the position of the cusp tip labial to the midline. Join the lines together. And here also I have to draw two lines. So this is the external outline. This area is the lingual ridge. And this area is the distal marginal ridge and distal cusp slope. Because the apex of the root is center and the root is cylindrical. The cervical line here, the curvature is 1.5 millimeter multiplied by 4. Then here, I have to go 6 millimeters with this mark here. This is the position of the cervical and join the two sides together, labially and lingually. On the root, there is a developmental depression. In the root, there is a developmental depression in the middle third of the root, like it was on the medial side, but on the distal, it is deeper. So make the marking more deeper, more color. Incisally, the crown is, as you said, imperfect diamond shape. You have to draw the box here. The measurements are the maximum contour mesiodistally and the maximum contour labiolingually. Mesiodistally, the crown is 13, so the width of the box will be 30 millimeters, and the length will be 32 millimeters. So this box is 30 by 32. 30 millimeters, 15, 15, and here I have to go 16 and 16. Inside this box, I have to draw a crown. At first, mark the position of the two contact points. This is the medial contact point. Here is the distal contact point. Then draw the mesial half of the crown, which resembles the anterior tip convex line. And draw the distal half of the crown, which is slightly concave here in the middle, because it resembles the posterior teeth, the premolars, like there is a depression here in the labial side of the crown. Posteriorly or lingually, mark the position of the lingual fossa as we have done in the central incisor. And two lines come out of this toward the mesial and the distal cusped, mesial and distal contact point. This is the cusped and the two cusp lobes from the cusped center toward the distal contact point and the mesial contact point. Draw the position of the labial ridge. This is the labial ridge, which is curved toward the medial side. Mark the position of the single and two lines toward the contact point, and then divide the lingual fossa into two parts, mesiolingual and distolingual fossa. By this, we have finished the form of the incisor aspect of the. This is, in general, the whole aspect together, the labial, the lingual, the mesial, and the distal. And as we can see here, we wrote the name of the aspect, labial aspect, and here, mesial and distal. In the lingual aspect, everything is the same as the labial, but you cannot see the mesial becomes left and the distal becomes to the right side. The two images are the same. But what is different, what we draw inside here, the labial ridge, which is curved towards the mesial. Proximal aspects, this is the mesial aspect, and this is the distal aspect. They are the same, but what is different in between is the developmental depression on the mesial is shallower than it is on the distal. Distal is deeper, and the cervical point here on the mesial, it is more curved than it is on the distal side. The name of the aspect, mesial aspect, here will be the labial, here will be the lingual, and on the distal, the same as the first one, but we reverse everything. From the incisal aspects, in the anterior area will be labial, posteriorly lingual, here is the mesial, here the distal. The name of the aspect is incisal aspect. These are the landmarks that the student should write. Give the names and write the meaning on the next.